Welcome to the introduction to Squirrel Programming. Today, we're going to introduce, finally, what OOP is. It's an object-oriented programming. What is OOP? Object-oriented programming is a programming language model where instead of commonly relying on functions and logic, it relies on organizing the data as objects. OOP benefits reusability, scalability, and efficiency. It is always used in video games, Java, and almost every C# and C++ program, and many more. Why OOP? OOP focuses on how you can manipulate an object instead of relying on how the logic is used to manipulate them. OOP is fantastic for large and further expanding projects due to how easy it is to manipulate the objects. OOP is fantastic for group work, as OOP doesn't depend on other classes to develop. This is true in most cases. Squirrel and OOP. Squirrel's take on OOP isn't complex compared to C# and Java. For this example, we'll compare C# to Python and then Python to Squirrel. So we're comparing a statically typed language to a dynamically typed language, and then we're going to convert a dynamically typed language to an R dynamically typed language. One to the left is C#, quite popular for how it's implemented OOP, and one to the right is the same thing from the left, but converted to Python. Notice as Python's way of representing a class is more simplistic than compared to C# way of implementing a class. And here's an example from Python to Squirrel. Nothing much has changed, but we notice as we kind of have the syntax look of C# combined with the way of how Python handles it. Compared to C#, Squirrel requires less syntax to make the same class. Every class in every object-oriented program, every variable is set to private. You don't need to do this with Squirrels. Since Squirrel is a dynamically typed language, we do not need to specify in the class's blueprint what ID a name is. We can just assign them null for now. Four principles of OOP. A class will contain encapsulation, abstraction, inheritance, and polymorphism. Encapsulation. Encapsulation is the mechanism of hiding implementation from the user. All fields should be private and should only be changed with getters and setters with public methods if it's referenced out with the class. A getter is a public method or function which fetches and grabs the information from the class. It's a good practice to start with a prefix, get, but it's up to you to decide what the prefix should be. A setter is a public method which assigns the field inside the class with the object that is passed in from a parameter. It's also a good practice to start with a prefix, set, but again, it's up to you to decide what prefix you want to use. In object-oriented programming, fields shouldn't be assigned directly, but that's with exceptions. You'll see this later on. A getter tends to have a get prefix in methods and function names. It will always contain a return keyword if it's a function. A setter does not return back a value, with exceptions, and it doesn't use a return but assigns the field directly. Abstraction is the opposite of encapsulation. It shows what's important to the class to implement. It's kind of like a contract. All fields and methods are exposed out in the open. You are forced to implement the features which are stated when you inherit it. You are unable to do this with Squirrel natively, but it is still achievable. For this example, we'll use the Shape class. This will be our base class. This class holds the blueprint of what the shape color is, the shape's type, where it is positioned in the screen, and what size it is on the screen. We have a constructor which initializes each variable, because remember, every variable in the class should be set to private. We should not be able to access these fields out with the constructor. A constructor is used to initialize the variables from the class, and it's not a good practice if you initialize the class without a constructor. We have a method called display, which displays back the information from the class. Remember that a class is just a blueprint. We have the fields that make the shape. This is the fundamentals of the class. We have a constructor which initializes the fields from the parameters that are passed into it. Remember, this is due to encapsulation. We have a normal method which can be classed as a getter, but I decided not to use the get prefix inside the method's name. We have a setter with a prefix to change the shape's properties. Note that there is no return, it's just direct assignment to the fields. Abstraction with classes. This uses the keyword extends. We can now extend it into our three shapes. So we have three classes, square, triangle, and circle. Each one includes the extends shape at the end of it. Since each class now implements the shape class, all the information from the shape class is already accessible inside each of those classes. We don't need to rewrite the whole code from shape as it already implements it. All we have to do is to create a constructor, and this constructor we'll call the base constructor, which is the shape class. So each class has a constructor which initializes the base constructor with the correct properties. Since abstraction is like a contract, each shape has assigned an agreement to use the fields and methods or functions from the shape class out implementing it. This means these classes can access or change the behavior while not affecting the base class. And this is one of the good things about abstraction. Abstraction with classes. Once extended, it can overwrite or add functions on top of the classes. This is also known as overriding. Now, let's invoke and make some shapes. The code. We have an array initialized using an array literal. That is an array that's created using square brackets. In this array, we have a square constructor, we have a triangle constructor, and we have the circle constructor. First item in each parameter represents what color the shape is. Then all the other settings are the same throughout. We have a method called addPrintBar, which will add a bar on top of the text. We have another method called printArray, which has a parameter of r. This includes the addPrintBar method, and inside both of those methods, we have a forEach loop which iterates over the arrays in shapeArray and calls its display method. Then we change each shape's position using a forEach loop, because remember from the last tutorial that a for loop has direct access to arrays, and then we will print out the new arrays. And for the each loop, we will iterate through every array in the shapeArray. Then we use the setChangePoints method and input the parameters of randomInt, which is a function which returns a random number from 0 to 100. This will randomize a random number for the x and the y coordinates. And then we reprint out the array, and this is the result. Success! We've managed to change each shape's position. This is only using one constructor and no extra implementations. This is a good thing with abstraction and object-oriented programming. The for loop randomizes from 0 to 100 for each shape's x and y coordinates. This is polymorphism, the ability to make an operator or function achieve different results based on inputs. We have to remember that a class is a blueprint. It just holds what information the class has. We have to invoke it to gain some results. Each element is unique in its own way, therefore making your project more scalable. Inheritance. If your family has a history of dyslexia or Erlen, there is a chance that you might inherit. Inheritance in OOP is just like that, but with more control of what to inherit. Using the same class, which is the base class of shape class, we can make a shape inherits its own way of displaying back information. This is also called overriding. For us to override, all we have to do is rewrite the name of the function and only change the inside of that method or function. And now, each time that we display back the information, notice that square and triangle has different print methods compared to the circle. Both square and triangle implement a new display method which overrides the base display method. Circle's display method hasn't been overrided, so it still uses the base display from shape class. Inheritance gives your classes a different behavior, so create a base class and stop implementing the same patterns. Let's go over the same things, but this time with an actual file. This file is accessible in the description below. Remember to save it as a .NET file format. You may use this in Visual Studio Code or Notepad++ or any other editing program that you're happy with. So the first one is our Abstract class, or base class. This class is called Shape. Shape has 6 different fields, each assigned null. We have a constructor which has 6 different parameters. Each parameter initializes it directly to the variable here. This is due to encapsulation. We use the this keyword to reference that we want to change this onto this object itself. We have the display function. The display function displays back information as a string. We have the format function, which returns back a string. We input its shapes type, color, its points, and its sizes. Percentage sign and s means that this is a string. Percentage sign and the I means this is an integer. So the first percentage and the s is this shape type, and this goes onwards as you go down. We have our other method called set change points, which has 2 parameters, x and y. We directly change the values from the class using this keyword again. This time, making sure that we assign it to the parameters. And then we have our 3 classes here. I spelled triangle wrong, but who cares? We have the extends shape at the end of class square, class triangle, and class circle. Both of these classes implement their own way of displaying back the information. This is called overriding, and this is due to inheritance. We have constructor, which calls the shape's constructor. Circle doesn't have any overriding functions, so it's just simplistic constructor. So circle will use the shape's class's display method instead. We have the shape array, using an array literal. If you square bracket, then we initialize the shape's color, its position in the screen, and its size in the screen. The add print bar simply adds a little tiny bar. Well, this is for displaying back the information. The main function is in here. Print away. It has a parameter named r, which inputs an array. We call this method again, and then we go through each item in shape array. Then we call every object's display function, and this is the random int function, which creates a random number between 0 to 100, and then we return it back. So this here, this is a function, and we use Squirrel's constant variable called randmax, where it holds the maximum numbers Squirrel can hold. We use the print array function, and then we call the for each loop, which directly goes to each element in the array. It calls the set change points in every object within the array. Then we change its x and its y coordinates within a shape, and then we re-display it back. Hopefully this tutorial has been easy, and for our next tutorial, we'll be making Simon Says. See you soon.